Welcome again to Bellarine Presbyterian Church as we pre-record a service for this coming Sunday. We don't know at this time what changes to the COVID regulations are going to come in Victoria. We'd love it if the changes came so that we could meet again in person. But for the meantime, we are pre-recording and we pray that God will bless us who do it here at Bellarine and you in your homes who watch and listen to it. Let us hear the word of Scripture as we commence our service from Isaiah chapter 12. And I'm reading verses 4 to 6. Give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples, proclaim that his name is exalted. Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done gloriously. Let this be made known to all the earth. Shout and sing for joy, O inhabitants of Zion. For great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel. And it's that Holy God that we come to worship, and we lift up our voices in song now as we turn to rejoice, number 508, Through All the Changing Scenes of Life. The tune is Wiltshire, and after we sing, Reverend John Cromarty will lead us in prayer.
Blessings that are ours in Christ Jesus. We thank you this day for his advent into this world of sin and shame and his willing identification with sinners like us. And we bless you, Father, that he bore the punishment that we deserve. As your word says, he was made a curse for us. Oh, how our sins deserve your judgment. And we deserve to be judged. But here is that one, that son of yours, who in our place was condemned and who sealed our pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a saviour. And we pray that the message of the gospel will extend throughout the district here. The message of Christ crucified and risen will go into the homes in our district and throughout our state and nation and to the ends of the earth. O God, may your Holy Spirit bring true revival in our day. Come into the lives of men and women and boys and girls. Reveal to them their need. Show them the Saviour. And, O God, bring them to that living faith in Christ, which will deliver them from all condemnation. Father, we thank you again for each other. We thank you for your word. And we thank you that Alistair is here today to unfold the truth of your word to us. May we all be given hearing ears and understanding hearts. And would you give Alistair the words to speak that we need to hear today for our good and for your glory. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We come now again to our memory verse. This month we are working from the book of Proverbs again, chapter 18 and verse 10. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous man runs into it and is safe. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 10. Last week John used an illustration concerning flood time on the Hunter River in New South Wales, where his father or his grandfather and grandmother had a refuge up in a Moreton Bay fig tree that they could go to, the flood house. I want to use a different illustration, but to make exactly the same point. On the northeast coast of England, there is a little island, Lindisfarne, where there has been a monastery from about the 6th century AD. You can only get to the island in low tide. There's a causeway there. Many people in the past have been caught by it. Now that there are signs, and there's a refuge in the middle of it in case that you were caught. At least every month, the authorities have to come in and rescue a car that is caught. You can leave it 3 hours after high tide, you could start to come, and then so long before the tide turns, you can also cross. But if you miss out on that, you have to find refuge. You have to escape in some way. Now, that's exactly the imagery that John had last week in dealing with this verse, and I want to stress it. God has revealed himself to be a safe refuge for his people. We're safe in the arms of Jesus, the hymn says. And that's a very wonderful thing, to know that we can come to him as the refuge, the one who has the strength and the power and the willingness to aid his people and to keep them safe at all times. But I want also to stress the setting of this verse in the book of Proverbs. When we come to the scriptures, we often have favourite verses that we can pick out. They may be out of their context. But we always have to look, what is the context of a particular verse that we have chosen? And there's a context here in Proverbs 18. Because the following verse goes on to make a contrast. Let me read verse 10 and then 11. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous man runs into it and is safe. A rich man's wealth is his strong city, and like a high wall in his imagination. We have been told here that, on the one hand, a righteous man runs for refuge to the Lord. A wealthy man trusts in his wealth. He thinks he's safe with that. He can buy what he wants. He can do what he wishes with his money. But there's the contrast. A righteous man depends upon God. An unrighteous man depends often upon his wealth. He depends upon mammon. And as the scripture points out repeatedly, you cannot serve both masters. You serve one or the other. And so either we know the name of the Lord, the revelation that God has made about himself, and we trust in him and we depend upon him day by day. We depend upon him, of course, for our salvation, but we depend upon him in his providential care day by day as well. And the contrast? No, we don't want to go that way and think that we can find something in ourselves or in our possession that will be a substitute for that refuge. Because other refuge have I none. I need the refuge that is God himself. So let us say the verse again and remember that contrast that is here in this setting in Proverbs 18. Proverbs 18, verse 10, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous man runs into it and is saved. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 10. We're going to sing now a verse that's, or a hymn that stresses for us what it is to take our refuge in the Lord. We're going to sing 486 from Rejoice. It's really a setting from Psalm 91, taking various verses of it. Safe in the shadow of the Lord, beneath his hand and power. Commandment that I command you today, you shall be careful to do, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land that the Lord swore to give to your fathers. And you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. And he humbled you, and let you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know what man, that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing did not wear out on you, and your foot did not swell those 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, the Lord your God disciplines you. So you shall keep the commandments of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and by fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you to a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and springs, flowing out of the valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron and out of whose hills you can dig copper, and you shall eat and be full, and you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Take care lest you forget the Lord your God by not keeping his commandments and his rules and his statutes, which I command you today, lest when you have eaten and are full and have built good houses and live in them, and when your herds and flocks multiply and your silver and gold is multiplied and all that you have is multiplied, then your heart be lifted up, and you forget the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt and out of the house of slavery, who led you through the great and terrifying wilderness with its fiery serpents and scorpions and thirsty ground where there was no water, who brought you water out of the flinty rock, who fed you in the wilderness with manna that your fathers did not know, that he might humble you and test you to do you good in the end. Beware that lest you say in your heart, my power and the might of my hand have gotten me this wealth. You shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth, that he may confirm his covenant that he swore to your fathers, as it is this day. And if you forget the Lord your God and go after other gods and serve them and worship them, I solemnly warn you today that you shall surely perish. Like the nations that the Lord makes to perish before you, so shall you perish, because you would not obey the voice of the Lord your God. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word, and may by his Spirit he help us by giving us understanding of it. Let us come now to again approach our God in prayer. Let us all pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for that reading of Scripture. A reading that comes from a passage of warning that Moses gave to the children of Israel long ago. How blessed they were, but yet how they so often forgot you and turned to their own ways. May we never forget the one who is our Saviour. Help us ever to have in mind the greatness of that work of the Lord Jesus in coming to this world of ours in the fullness of time to redeem us at the cost of his own blood. Thank you that we are part of the church which he purchased with his blood. And help us to rejoice in the communion of saints to which we belong. We have our own fellowship of saints here in this congregation. We share with the wider fellowship with the saints of God with whom we have contact and whom we meet with, whom we know, and others that we only hear about, who have come to a like faith in the Lord Jesus. Thank you that you are the builder of the church, and that not even the gates of hell are going to prevail against it. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you will bless us as we worship you. Be our teacher. Help us to listen attentively to your word and give us a will that responds gladly to what you command us to do. May we be known as those who love the scriptures and who seek to follow its directions. We pray for each one of us. We're in a situation here in Australia and here in Victoria at the moment that is foreign to us because we've never been through these experiences before. At times when we are cut off from others, remind us that you were ever near and that you will sustain and keep your children and you will bring blessing to them, even at times when they're unable to meet with fellow Christians or even have contact with their own families. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you will remind us constantly that you are the great God who is in control of all things and you are working out your purposes. And we know that you do all things well. Bless us then, we pray, from day to day. Help us to look to you and not only to look in the local sense, but give us a vision of the worldwide extent of the gospel and help us to think of the future when the day will come when everyone will have known of the name of the Lord Jesus and every knee will bow before him who was Lord of Lords and King of Kings. We thank you that Christian work goes on among us and in many other places as well. We thank you that for those who are involved in the internet broadcasts, in radio, in television, for those who are involved in Christian printing and publication, we think of the work of translation of the Bible that still goes on in spite of COVID because of the tasks that lie ahead of us in that field. Lord, send more people out, we pray, to learn the languages, to translate, and then to have printed the scriptures that people may learn of the Saviour and that what are presently infant churches may be built up according to your word. Strengthen, we pray, the resolve of Christians in this day in which we live to live for the Lord. May we seek to set aside things that are of the secular culture around us and may we be noted as those really who have been with the Lord Jesus and who desire to live for him. Lord, you have redeemed your people and helped them, we pray, to show forth the reality of their faith by living unto you. Bless us now as we continue to worship, as we sing, as we listen to your word, as we pray, and we pray that you, after this service, will send us on our way rejoicing and confident of your presence and of your grace with us. And we pray everything in Jesus' name. Amen. Before Alastair McEwen comes to read the scriptures and to preach, we're going to sing a setting of the Lord's Prayer. It is taken from Trinity Hymnal, Our Father, Lord of Heaven and Earth, sung to the tune Melita.
For glory, strength, and heaven's sake. chapter 6, and we'll read from verse 1 to verse 15. Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 to 15. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them, for then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they'll be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then like this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father forgive your trespasses. This is the word of God. Of course, we're looking at the Lord's Prayer, and it's part of the Sermon on the Mount, and of course the Sermon on the Mount is part of Scripture, and there's no doubt that Scripture is particularly is relevant when you think about it, and this, for sure. A way to think about it is to think of your favourite meal. Sometimes when we drive from point A to point B and there's not much, it's a bit boring. It's interesting to ask people about what meal would they like, and they start to think about how it is, and they start to salivate as they go along the road. But it's just good to think about what's your favourite meal, because what this part of the Lord's Prayer is talking about is this reality. Now, of course, many people pray the Lord's Prayer. They pray with the Lord's Prayer and in a desperate situation. I was seeing something the other day on television about the 9/11, the Twin Towers, when they went down in New York. And this chap said that there was this woman who was injured and he prayed the Lord's Prayer with her. And that's not bad, depending on what he meant by it, of course. But this prayer is, though many people would use it, it's a prayer for Jesus' disciples, as we know. And it's called the Lord's Prayer, but as we've said, it's the disciples' prayer. And so it's for us, who belong to the Lord Jesus, who follow him. It's given to us by the Lord Jesus, who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood. And it's our Lord and Saviour who's given us this, because it honours God, but also it honours, it's good for us as well. And we've looked at the beginning of this prayer already, and we're up to the fourth request. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And now, give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. And I think we'll see that it's very relevant for us, and you've already been thinking about that from the beginning. But just, of course, remember we're studying the Lord's Prayer not so that we can have more information, not so that we get all our theology correct. We want to get our theology correct. But we're not just studying it for that reason. We're doing it so that we might pray better, so that we might pray the Lord's Prayer, or follow the pattern of the Lord's Prayer, and know what we're praying. Because sometimes we can read Scripture or we could go through the Lord's Prayer and not actually know it, though we know what we mean. And so it's good prayer, and studying makes us think about what it means. And we want to do that particularly today with this next petition. The fourth petition, the fourth request: give us this day our daily bread. And the first thing is that it can be difficult to pray for food. Well, I can find it difficult to pray for food. Give us this day our daily bread. I mean, it's not difficult to understand. We know what the words mean, although there's one word here, the word daily. It's a rare word. We're not 100% sure what it means, but daily sounds best, and that's fine. So this request is not difficult to understand what the words mean. Yet, it can be difficult to pray and to mean in our situation. To pray and to mean. Now, I'm saying that about myself, and I have the advantage that when I have to preach, I have to prepare and think about this. And so that's a challenge to me. But now, as we're thinking about this now, what about you? Well, it can be difficult for this reason. The prayers we mean most are prayers for our felt needs. Your child is lost, you pray, and you really mean it. The needed check, you know, you need the money to come through, you really pray, Lord, please look after us here. Or a loved one is sick. Or when we're in worry and we cast our burden on the Lord, pass an exam, family member to be saved, for a sin that you keep falling into. Things that really touch us, we mean when we pray. But the supply of food, I mean really, the supply of food, we, at least I, don't usually feel this is a needy thing. And I wonder about you as well. Of course, in the New Testament times when Jesus was teaching his disciples this prayer, more people would feel this need to pray for food more often than we do. People were much more, much closer to agriculture. And so if agriculture failed, they felt it. A wider group of the society felt the problem. They knew intimately, they knew personally about crop failure and hunger, real hunger. So it's probably easier for them to pray, give us this day our daily bread, and mean it. And of course, this is not just New Testament times. We know there are other parts of the world where this is true as well. Agricultural societies where they have droughts and famines and they don't have backup and their food security is very low. So we know there are people who feel this today. Seemingly, the statistic I got, that there are 800 million people in the world who don't have enough food to be healthy. That doesn't affect me. But there are these people in the world. But also, we may come closer to home, perhaps, and say that drought, because we have droughts in this country, or fire, we're aware of that, or flood, can affect the farmers and the towns in our country, and they feel it as well. And in those sort of situations, praying, give us this day our daily bread, can be much more meaningful. But I don't know about you, and as I was re-preparing this, I was thinking, well, I'm not sure about everyone's situation, but I think I live, and most of us perhaps, live in a bubble, a 21st century Western society, somewhat affluent bubble. Most of us are protected from lack of food and lack of a lot of other things as well. So that's why I'm suggesting it can be difficult for us to pray this and mean it, because we're in this bubble. And I had breakfast this morning and I've had something for lunch. I just don't feel it. So, what about you? What about me? How often do I pray, or we pray, give us this day our daily bread and mean it? Maybe all the time. Maybe. But it's a challenge to me, and maybe to you as well. Maybe, perhaps, we would pray this prayer and mean it more if we remembered some basic things, which are true. And everyone's going to agree with this, of course, but keeping in the front of our mind and it affecting us, that God, the first, God is the one who gives us our food. God is the one who gives us our food. You see, getting food each week can be so automatic. We can forget. You go to the supermarket and there it is. That's where most of us get our food. But it's not the supermarket, it's not the farmers who give us our food. It's God who gives us our food, every mouthful of it. As well, that favourite meal that we were just thinking about, every mouthful of that is from the Lord. And it can be easy to forget that it's God who gives us our food, because we go to the supermarket or the farmer's market or wherever we go and the shelves are full. And we go back in 3 days' time and the shelves are full again. That's just how it is usually. Sometimes in the pandemic, the shelves disappear. In fact, this is an aside, but I preached a sermon before. And I preached it and I said, God can take away our food. And that was just before the pandemic struck. Whew, and the shelves were actually empty. So when people went along, they realised the reality of this truth. But generally, we don't expect that. And because we don't, we forget that our food comes from God. And God only, we don't think about it. He gives us our daily bread. But it's true. He gives us our food, all of it. And we shouldn't forget. Now, there's a worse scenario than forgetting that God gives us our food. Or at least a flow on from it. We can have all this food and lots of things, and we can forget God himself. And that was the problem that Moses was warning the people about in Deuteronomy chapter that we read, Deuteronomy 8. A free translation, or sum it up. Watch out when I give you lots of things that you don't forget me. That's what he's really saying. When you get lots of things, which you enjoy, and remember God gives us everything to enjoy, but don't forget me. The wise man in Proverbs 30, Agur, prayed, give me neither poverty or riches, but give me only my daily bread. Now, I remember I prayed that once and somebody said to me they didn't like me praying that, but it's in the Bible and it's a pretty good prayer because they didn't think that we shouldn't say to God, don't give me riches. But that's an aside. But he's prayed, give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. And then what? He gives a reason. Otherwise, I might have too much and disown you and say, who is the Lord? We can get comfortable in all our possessions and the things we have. And maybe we'd never tick the box, I've forgotten the Lord, but in practice, that's how we can be. So I ask the question, when have you been most aware of God having to provide for you? Well, when your bank balances hit the floor or you're out of a job. That's when you realise it. That's when you pray, Lord, help me. Give us this day our daily bread. When have you been most thankful for the Lord providing for you in that sort of situation? You know, it's been going badly and there it is. And it's magnificent. And you say, thank you. Because we can forget when we have plenty. So there's real dangers in having plenty. We can forget that our Father in heaven provides our food every day. And we can forget God himself in a practical way, in a real way. We're warned about this. And so let's not forget that God, our loving Father, the giver, the provider of everything. I mean, the scripture tells us this. Psalm 145. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand, you satisfy the desire of every living thing. See, it's God gives it. That's great there, Psalm, to praise God with, and to confess that. Or Psalm 104. You cause the grass to grow for the livestock, and plants for man to cultivate, that he may bring forth food from the earth, and wine to gladden the heart of man, oil to make his face shine, and bread to strengthen his heart. You cause the grass to grow. God does it. God does it. I think part of the problem is we live in a scientistic world, society, you know. Science can... and we have all these explanations about science. But God is behind science. He's the one who gives or takes away. In the New Testament, Paul and Barnabas. Barnabas and Paul are at Lystra. And the locals want to worship them. And they point away from themselves. Of course, they point to God. What do they say about God? He's the one who did you good by giving you rains from heaven and fruitful seasons, satisfying your hearts with food and gladness. It's a theme throughout the scripture. God, our Father in heaven, is the one who gives us our food. And he does this because he's generous and he's kind and he's loving. And when we and others don't ask him or thank him, he still gives us things because he's kind. So, why pray to our Heavenly Father, give us this day our daily bread? Because he is the one who does it. But here's another reason, it's a basic reason, another reason to ask God to give us our daily bread. Because he may not give us our food. He may not give us our food. Now, for us, he usually does. We know that. For the majority of people around the world, he does. But he may not. Think of a situation in Ahab's day. We think of Elijah the prophet at that time. This is what Elijah says. As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives whom I serve, there will be neither dew nor rain from heaven in the next few years except by my word. And there wasn't. There was a drought. And some more than others, but we have an idea what a drought looks like. And there was a drought and there was no food. It petered out. The Lord stopped giving food. And he may do that for us as well. He may do that for us as well. Think again of droughts our country has faced. Fires that have raged. Floods that have occurred. And in some places these have really touched food supplies. Not just farmers, but us as well, can be affected by these sorts of things. And droughts the country has faced and fires that have raged and may return, summer's coming, and floods in some places are also from the hand of God. Now, I'm not saying some floods, I'm saying sometimes there are floods, and when there are, they're from God's hand. They're all from God's hand. And the pandemic as well. See, yes, and the pandemic as well. And so when those supermarket shelves are lost because everyone panics and goes and takes everything away, but the pandemic itself is also from God's hand. It's not an accident. Now, people may not like to think about that. We may not like to think about that, but it's true. It's true. God may cause things to happen so that food is not readily available. And I suggest in our relative comfort, I don't know about you, I'm thinking about myself, but think about this and apply it to your own situation. In our relative country, in our state of enjoyment of God's gifts, we can forget who God is and what he does and that he's active. God hasn't gone to sleep at the wheel. That's not why we've got the pandemic or floods or fires. And this is very solemn. This is very solemn. Now, Isaiah says this, and the Lord says this through Isaiah. I form light and create darkness. I make well-being and create calamity. I am the Lord. I am Jehovah who does all these things. Amos says, he asks this rhetorical question. Does disaster come to a city unless the Lord has done it? And we know what the answer is. That is, God, our Father, does all these things. He's in control. Now, it's sobering, it's humbling, but it's true. It's reality. Now, God's not arbitrary in what he sends. He's not capricious, he's not unjust, he's not grumpy, he's not unloving. He does all these things for a good reason. When he sends darkness or famine or affliction or fire or flood or famine or a pandemic, He'll do it for right and good reasons in the 21st century as well as in the 8th century BC. Even if we don't understand it fully, because often we don't understand how these things are. One of our elders said once, God gives us the things that we would have prayed for if we knew as much as he knows. God knows everything. We only know this little bit, and we ask, and we think, God, why aren't you doing what I ask you? But God's got a bigger plan. That doesn't mean he doesn't respond to our prayers. But he does all these things for good reasons, and he may choose not to give us food, any food, for good reasons. And I was thinking, what might this be? Well, he might not give us food because it'll make us wake up and think, Lord, we need to pray about this. It may be a way that it draws us closer to him because we see our need. Now, I'm not praying for this. We had Nigerian students at the college for a while. One of the things they'd say, if something was they really didn't want, they'd say, I do not pray for that. It was their way of saying, I pray against that. Yeah. Well, I do not pray that the Lord will take away all our food. But he may. And so that we will trust the giver more than the gift, or be drawn closer to him, or trust him more. I don't expect it. And even as I wrote this down, I don't expect him to. And it might be dangerous saying that, but I don't expect him to. But even as I say I don't expect him to, it makes me recognise my dependence on him for my food today and tomorrow. And so it's in this context that we pray, give us this day our daily bread. And God is not obliged to give us anything, is he? I mean, he's not begrudging. He's not begrudging. He doesn't say, oh, no, I don't really like these people. But he's not obliged. And so we should humbly pray, shouldn't we? Give us this day our daily bread. Because we recognise our absolute dependence on him. That it's not automatic. It comes from his hand. So, give us this day our daily bread is not thanking God for our food. But we should thank God for our food as well. This is sort of a spin-off. Afterwards, when he gives it to us, because it's a gift. All our food is a gift. We should thank him for it. Sincerely. There's a practice, maybe there are people here who can straighten me out on this, but I believe there's a practice in Scotland where they not only gave thanks before the meal, but gave thanks after the meal. That's not a bad idea, is it? When do you feel happiest? After the meal, don't you? And what do? You thank the hostess. Or you thank, right? But, man, at the end of a meal to say, thank you, Lord, that was magnificent. Yeah. So I'm just saying, part of this, a spin-off, is to give us this day our daily bread, then is to recognise it and say, thank you for giving us our food today. Thank you, Father. So thinking about this, there's another aspect that it's worth keeping in mind when we pray, give us this day our daily bread. And that is, we pray for the basics. We pray for the basics, don't we? Give us this day our daily bread. That which sustains life and health. I mean, that doesn't mean we shouldn't pray for more or for other things, but that's the prayer here. That's the basic. It focuses on our basics. And when we do focus on the basics, we see how much more than the basics the Lord gives us. I mean, he gives us our daily, well, I can't speak for you. He gives me my daily bread. He gives me heaps of my daily bread. He gives me more than my daily bread, you know. You've got to be careful because you don't know what people like and don't like, okay. Do you like having a hot shower? I like having a hot shower. God gives us hot showers. Do you like having an electric blanket? Yeah, some people don't like electric blankets. I like having an electric blanket. God gives us electric blankets. Isn't that magnificent? That's more than daily bread. I mean, God is good. But you see here, give us this day daily bread, the basics. But he gives us so much more. So, I don't know where you're at, but I think that's really, you might be struggling to get by in the pandemic or the lockdown. But generally, think about it, and I think about it myself, for me. Have a look at the shelves in your fridge. And the fridge drawer, and the crisper, and the freezer, Do you have more than basics? Well, I have more than basics. Okay. Just tell me that. And maybe you don't. Okay. But we do at our place. Check out the cupboards and the pantry. Check out the compost bin. What has God given us? If the benchmark's the basics, then there's a lot of stuff the Lord gives us beyond our daily bread. It's a bonus. So much to thank God for when we think about it. Now, in our busyness, in our hurry, we don't think about that. But there it is. And it's good to think about it and say, thank you, Lord, for all those things. So give us this day our daily bread. It's a prayer for basics. We think about what God's given us unbegrudgingly, generously, lovingly, willingly. It encourages me, doesn't it encourage us, to thank God for so much. Now, just one more point on this. When we get the best basics, which we do, when we get the extras, or as many extras, when we get the basics and don't get the extras or not as many extras as others, then what? And this is an aside, but it's just good to think about because we're thinking about these provision that God provides. What about when we don't get as many extras as other people? It can be a challenge because it can be easy to be envious. It's easy for me to be envious. I don't know about you, but you look at someone else and they've got it. Why haven't I got it? And this can happen not just when you look at the world, because you say, well, that's the world, but when other Christians get more than you, and you say, well, Lord, you might not say it, but maybe in the back of your head somewhere you can think, Lord, why am I not, how come they're getting, and I'm, it can just happen, right? I'm just saying. And I think we need to keep that in mind. It can be easy to be envious. See? And the Lord our Saviour, doesn't want us to be envious of what other people have. And he's given us his Holy Spirit so that we might learn not to be envious. I mean, because we can slip that way, that's sin, we're still sinners. But the Holy Spirit enables us to be content. It's not always easy, but to be content. Listen to the Lord Jesus. Take care and be on your guard against all covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. Take care and be on your guard against all covetousness. And the Lord's saying that because this is a temptation with respect to possessions and the things that the Lord gives us, including more than our daily bread. Listen to Paul. But godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world, and we cannot take anything out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. Content. The Lord Jesus died to change us in order that we learn, amongst other things, to be content, trusting our Heavenly Father. He knows what's best for us. He loves us. We thank him for what he's given us. We ask him for what we need. And he gives us usually the basics and more, much more, things to thank him for. Particularly when we pray, give us this day our daily bread. And so, what's your favourite meal? Every mouthful comes from your loving Heavenly Father. Every mouthful. Let's thank him for that. And all his provisions, the basics and the extras. Remember that he's loving and he's kind. And he's done this, he does this for us, time and time again. And so thank him, but also pray. And learn to mean, give us this day our daily bread. So let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you that you give us so much in this country. Please forgive us for our discontent when it comes up. Lord, we really thank you that you give us so much and we do enjoy it and appreciate it. But we don't want to forget you, and we thank you again for your kindness, and we do pray that you'll continue to provide for us what we need. Give us day by day our daily bread, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
We draw our service to a close by singing to God's praise in 609 in Rejoice. For the fruits of his creation, the tune is All Through the Night. Knowing that you will care for us, you will open your hand wide to provide for our needs. May we live then by faith in the providence of our gracious God. Help us to think too of the needs of others and to make provision for them also, taking care to look after the needs of the household of faith first and then to provide for others as well. Bless us then in our service for you, and may we be able to show in this way the compassion of the Lord Jesus. And now may the blessing of the eternal God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit remain upon and rest with each one of us, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.